Welcome to segment 5 of our 5-part series. Our two consultants, Jill and Paul, have been applying new federal simulation guidance in a travel time reliability improvement study for their client, Brenda, at the state DOT. Brenda is hosting a webinar for other regional offices to discuss the new federal guidance and her experience so far applying it in the Marine Causeway study. Let's join the webinar, already underway.
One of my favorite elements of the updated guidance was this I-405 study, which appears in an appendix to the guide. The case study provides excellent motivation for why following the new guidance can be crucial for effective decision-making. The focus for this case study is on reducing delays and maintaining travel time reliability in a 30-mile-long congested commuter corridor near Seattle. Data for the study included traffic count, travel time, incident and weather data from a calendar year of weekdays near Interstate 405. The underlying issue in the case study is hypothetical and deals with emergency roadwork needed in the aftermath of an earthquake. We don't have many earthquakes here in our state. However, it did make me think of our recovery from Hurricane Belinda a few years ago.
Hey Brenda. This is Jerry from Seaport Operations here. I see your point 100% about that hurricane. I'm still trying to catch up on sleep from Belinda. I was up for 48 hours straight.
I think we all were. Here the earthquake creates some large sinkholes and other structural damage that must be repaired in 6 months to avoid more serious impact to the roadway. In order to keep freeway operations as close to normal over the 6-month recovery period, extensive night, weekend, and midday work is required. Two alternative plans are considered. The first conforms to standing local policy of no lane closures in the morning peak period. The second relaxes this policy and schedules work on some selected weekday mornings when travel demand is expected to be lower than average.
Pardon the interruption, this is Barty from headquarters. Couldn't all the work just be done at night?
No, there was too much work to do, even if all off-peak periods were utilized. Elements of the roadway had to be repaired within 6 months to avoid drastic structural problems. Utilizing cluster analysis, travel conditions in the network were characterized into 6 dissimilar and distinct travel conditions. This graphic, the travel condition dartboard, shows the 6 different conditions sized by how often these conditions occur. For example, a major incident in the presence of adverse weather occurs about 3% of all weekdays.
Brenda. This seems incredible. This is Wendy joining in from Region 4. Are similar data available to us?
I'll let my consultant, Paul, who is dealing with all the data in our Marine Causeway project, handle that one.
Greetings. Paul here from West Hills Consulting. The data wasn't available all in one place, but we were able to find these data from a variety of sources. We just had to assemble them. My guess is that in Region 4 you would find a similar situation.
6 simulation models were calibrated to these conditions. The case study showed that calibration of each model became progressively easier. Each alternative was analyzed using the 6 calibrated simulation models. Simulation results showed that doing the work in some predictably low-demand AM peak periods incurred lower costs, both hard and soft. Hard costs were associated with payments for the roadwork itself, to be borne by the state. The soft costs were delays borne by travelers in the corridor. Let's look at the right side of the screen first. Alternative 1 keeps the policy of no peak period lane closures. In Alternative 2, travel condition data were analyzed in concert with local school schedules to find days where morning demand might be lower than expected. Doing work on the predictably low-demand weekdays with additional incident management and traveler information services was about $80,000 more expensive. However, Alternative 2 saves more than $3 million in soft costs borne by travelers. Most interestingly, however, was a parallel analysis derived from a single average day analysis, which favored the less effective Alternative 1. This is because there was no way of representing the full range of variable conditions expected in the network.
Wait. I don't get it. Klaus here from AC Transit. Why did the two different ways of doing the analysis provide essentially the exact opposite recommendations?
Maybe I'll take this one. Hi. I am Jill from West Hills Consulting. Conditions in the 405 corridor were so variable and different that there was no one single day that could represent the complete range. When a single day was used, it overestimated the amount of delay caused by the planned morning work. This overestimation was enough to sway the results of the study. When six different representative conditions were used in the analysis, it was clear that the delays under the predictable low-demand days were much lower.
I think there are a lot of similarities with our current Marine Causeway project. I am working the simulation analytics now with my team from West Hills.
I totally agree with you, Brenda. For the Marine Causeway project, we have two alternatives, and one seems to be more effective in so-called abnormal conditions.
The data in the Marine Causeway really shows that there are almost no days that conform to a concept of normal with average demand, no incidents, and no weather impacts. If abnormal means a combination of variation in demand, incidents, and weather, then abnormal is the new normal, at least around here.
Our early results in the Marine Causeway project show a similar kind of finding. The advise and adapt alternative seems to be more effective for reliability.
That's very true. Further, Paul and I are teasing out other findings from the model to indicate which elements from both alternatives are most effective. We think that a hybrid of elements from both alternatives may be the best use of DOT funds to improve reliability in the Marine Causeway. Both alternatives have a mix of geometric and operational improvements. How well these improvements work together is a key insight gained from simulation. For example, it appears that targeted improvements to bottlenecks on the Victory Island Bridge are critical from one alternative. But this doesn't work well without stepped-up incident management and improved traveler information, both elements of the competing second alternative.
Terrific presentation, Brenda. This was eye-opening for me.
You and your team are leaders in the state for this kind of analysis. Thanks so much for sharing your findings with us.
I'm psyched to try this in my region. I think we need to apply this approach right away for our Petunia Beach accessibility study.
We hope you have enjoyed our series on the new federal guidance for traffic micro-simulation. For more details, check out the FHWA Traffic Analysis Tools website for more information, including the Traffic Analysis Tools Volume 3 document itself. Thank you.